The opinions expressed in this program are not those of CISA 7 or Time Warner Cable.
To order. We have six, probably going on seven board members present. I think Celestine's supposed to be here.
We have five going on six.
One is excused.
Ed.
Ed's not here.
That's right.
I forgot Ed was excused. And first, we'll start one. Also at the table, to my left, Dr. Michelle Langenfeld, our superintendent. We have members of the cabinet around the table. Our intercity student council representative today is Samantha Adler from East.
No, you switched.
Nancy.
Yeah.
Nancy
DeJesus.
From and then
East?
From
okay.
East. And then Luli is coming?
That
you think, okay.
It didn't start snowing yet, did
it? No,
it's
okay,
right.
Good.
It's beautiful out right now. Welcome.
And then also Sandy Heller, our board executive assistant. First, we have time for our public forum. This is a time for members of the community to speak before the board on any topic. Is there anyone tonight who'd like to speak before the board? Seeing none, we'll move to our teaching and learning work session, and that will be facilitated by Katie Maloney.
Thank you, Brenda. We have one discussion item this evening, and it's a concussion presentation. And I'll let Kim Paolo introduce our presenters.
All these fine young men in their ties tonight. We have to let Tim know, though, that he needed to wear a tie.
He's the AD in this one, all right? He's looking sporty.
Casual Monday, huh, Tim?
That's right. It's okay. So per your request, I believe, and I think it's a great topic to be able to come here and talk with you about tonight.
Especially
we could probably talk about this for days, quite honestly. So we have a team for you, and I'm going to let them do most of their introductions. That'll talk to you tonight about mostly the protocols, the processes that we use for our athletes, and not always athletes in our schools. Physical education students, someone that might get hurt in the hallway. I think they tap into our athletic trainers a lot about how we handle concussions in our district. We have a great partnership, I believe, through our activity directors and Bell and Health. We work together closely. They've been a great partner in helping us kind of figure out and make sure we're doing what we need to be doing. And then on the medical end, they know what they're doing. So I'm going to let them start off, and some will do some presenting. We have some here to answer any questions that you might have, and we'll get started. We're hoping for about a 20-minute presentation and then time for questions at the end.
Perfect.
Good.
Thank you. Mark, you want to start?
Hi there. My name is Mark Husen. I'm one of the team facilitators of the athletic training department for our Bell and Health Sports Medicine athletic training program. Just quick introductions. Jason Terry, he's one of our licensed athletic trainers. Chad Carter, another one of our licensed athletic trainers, covers at Green Bay East. And Dr. James Edmond, our medical director, that oversees our sports medicine physical therapy program. And we have Tim Flood, as you guys know. I'm not going to do a lot of the talking here tonight, actually. I'm going to leave it up to these guys. But I just want to kind of do a quick overview. Touch talking about our staffing. History of concussions, as you guys know, it's been a hot topic probably more in the last few years than 10 years ago, 20 years ago. But want to kind of talk about know, how this has come about and what do we do and how do we handle a concussion really from start to finish. We'll review all those from preseason education, academic accommodation, which is huge. It's, you know, how do we handle it once these kids are students? We can't forget that. It's not just athletics. So it's how do we handle in the schools, both for athletics and academics. Sideline injury management, what do we do when someone gets a concussion? We'll talk about what those process flows are in that injury care. And then post-injury care, how do we get them back on the field or court or school the most appropriate ways. Our sports medicine team, we've got over 30 what they call licensed athletic trainers, LATs, that are employed by Bell and Health. We do everything from a prevention assessment, referrals, return to play for both athletics and the academic side. Our biggest thing is we're just there for the athletes the majority of the time, but as like Kim said, sometimes it's that FIA department that comes and says, we had a kid that got hit in the head. What's our process flow with that? Our medical coverage, we've been covering the Green Bay School District since 1996. We've been very happy with working with it. And I think as we talk here tonight, you'll see things have grown because in 1996, we didn't have a lot of these options and process flows. It just, the technology wasn't there. So we've really developed a lot in the last few years. Our athletic trainers, we're governed by our national organization. We just had to turn in our CEUs just this last year, so we have a two-year cycle. As well as in the state, that's what we're, by the nationally, we're athletic training certified, but statewide, we're licensed athletic trainers. So every 2 years, we have to get recertified on that. I just want to bring up some key points because I think this is a huge value to us. Dr. James Evan, who is present here tonight, has been our medical director of physical therapy in the sports medicine department since 1996. In regards to the concussion, the impact, the big tool that we're going to talk about tonight, he is clinical interpretation qualified in 2006. That's when this area started using quite a bit. Fast forward to 2014, that's when he became certified as an impact CIC consultant. It's higher education, a lot more training with that. There's only one of two in the city of this area. In 2013-14, he became the NFL's, what they call UNC, Unaffiliated Neurocognitive Specialist, worked on visiting team sideline, and also in 2014 became an associate team physician of the Green Bay Packers. If we didn't have Dr. Evan, this isn't just about athletic trainers and what we can do at the schools. This is also that next level where we go with managing it for those cases that, you know, not every concussion has to be seen by a physician, but it's one of those things, what's that next step? Really after this, I'm gonna turn a lot of this over to Chad Carter. Chad works at Green Bay East. Tim and Chad worked together in this, putting the process flow together. He's got the rest of this, and if there's any questions, feel free to shoot them out to us.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. So that's a little bit about us, but what we wanted to do at a really kind of high level, so a lot of these are not very detailed, so if you do have questions, please do ask at the end because everyone up here is able to answer them, but what's changed? You know, we've said lots changed in the last 20 years. What's changed? The biggest thing that we think is public awareness. Public awareness has changed. A movie just came out about concussions. Mm-hmm. You know, people are saying that things are being squashed by the NFL because concussions, they don't want to mix. Legislation. In 2012, there's actually state laws that were signed right here in Green Bay to govern how the state and how, you know, we deal with concussions at the level, you know, of high school and below. So there's state laws that actually govern us all the way through that. And then there's education and research. In the medical profession, the easiest way to say it is we're smarter. You know, we're smarter now and people are more aware of what we're doing. So we're treating them, you know, better than they did in the past, you know. And people are more educated themselves. Parents and everyone else know, because of the hot button topic of concussions, what we're doing. So there's the state law. It was signed right here in Green Bay, like I said. And then right after that, the law was enacted on the 16th. And then actually the school board association came and said, we need to start working at the school levels to adapt this as well. So this is all kind of trickled down from the top and said, we need to do better in the schools and how we're treating our athletes and what we're doing. So a little bit about concussion history. Concussions are not new. They've been around for forever. okay? They're not new to us at Bellin. They're not new to kids in athletics. They're not new to anyone in school. Again, we just know more about them. They've not changed. But best practice for how we treat them has always been clinical evaluation. It's coming in and seeing an athletic trainer at your school. It's coming in and seeing, you know, the doctors. But now with the new laws and the education, we're trying to educate people, what are signs and symptoms? What are they? So they're not just sliding by anymore. And back when we were, I think we're all old enough in this room to say, well, he got his bell rung. Let him sleep it off. Check on him tomorrow. He's going to be fine. And then he can go back and play. That doesn't happen anymore. Okay, we've kind of changed how we've dealt with it because we are smarter and we're treating them the right way because of all the reasons that we talked about. We've also enacted IMPACT, okay, which is a computer-based test. So when you watch TV, this is how I explain it to mom and dads. When you watch TV and you hear someone going through in the NFL what they call the concussion protocol, this is the concussion protocol. Okay, they're using IMPACT or other tests like that. So our statistics since 06, we've done over 15,000 baseline tests on kids in this area. So at every one of our high schools here, and at every school that Bellin covered, we went out and did a presentation, about 45 minutes to an hour, about what happens in the schools when someone gets concussed. Now the great thing is we've done this since I've worked at Bellin back in 97 when I started. We've always kind of gone to the schools and said, we're going to treat this kid, here's how we're going to do it. But now we actually have official paperwork. We're working through the counselors. The counselors are calling the teachers and saying, okay, he's got two tests tomorrow. He just had a significant concussion. He shouldn't take that test. And when people don't understand it, this is how I explain it. If they were going to a PE class and they really sprained their ankle bad in a basketball game, no one would have any problems if they walked in with crutches and a big immobilizer on their ankle to say, oh, you can't do volleyball in gym class today. It's okay for you to sit on the side. You can be the scorekeeper. You can do an alternate activity today. No one would balk at that and say, yeah, that's right. Well, in math class, what the research and things that Jason has done a ton of the research on, to sit down and actually listen to the teacher and study and read or whatever the class is, that can be causing even more damage inside the brain, prolonging the effects of the concussion. But they look fine, they act fine. Why do they have to sit out a math class? Why shouldn't they go to science class? So that's what we're bridging the gap right now and really taking a proactive approach on getting the teachers involved and having the teachers fight with us on the front line to make sure that this injury is handled properly and handled efficiently to decrease the amount of lost time that any of these student athletes or anyone has. So that's in a nutshell what our academic accommodations do. We put them into different stages. Put them into different stages from 5, they're not in school anymore. They need to be home. Their best case is to be home. Down through 1, or 2 or 1, where you know they might need a little bit of extra time. They might need to eat lunch in a different room where it's quieter because that gives them a headache. But and then it guides our teachers through that whole process to allow them the best amount of recovery time. So why do we do this in the preseason? This is a quote that we got that I think is just great. Concussions, perhaps the only sports injury that directly impacts a child's ability to learn. When they hurt their brain through whatever method they hurt it, it can actually impair their ability to learn and retain information. And that's why they're here in school. So this is why we really looked at this as one of our serious things, and that's why some of the work that Jason and these guys did was so important to go through. So that's kind of what we do before school even starts. Once we get to our sports seasons, we do our pre-assessments, and that's our baseline impact testing. So every 2 years, we have the kids go through and take a baseline test. So it falls right in line with our what we refer to as our sports physicals, which you have to have them every 2 years. So we have the kids take a baseline test every 2 years. And that gives us the most up-to-date information. It's a computerized test that we do right in the school at the computer lab. We usually do it right during practice time. It takes about 45 minutes to an hour. And then that gives us their baseline that we can refer to later on. Since January 13, we've done over 3,600 baselines. And then start in the middle school this year. So we do them fairly regularly and actively.
Can I comment just on one thing, Chad?
Yeah.
I think we have to clarify what the impact test is. The impact test is a computerized test that really measures 4 different things. more than four, but it measures reaction time. It measures visual motor speed, how quickly your eyes work. It measures verbal memory, which is how you remember words. And it measures visual memory, which is really related to math-related skills. It's not an IQ test. We know there are national averages across the board. We know, like, an average reaction time is between 0.5 and 0.6 seconds. Or your visual motor speed, we know, is somewhere between 35 and 40 milliseconds. But for each individual athlete, we want to know what is their baseline. So what is their reaction time to begin with? What is their eye speed to begin with? We know some kids have a verbal brain and some kids have a visual brain. So how do they remember things? Are they a verbal memory person or a visual memory person? The reaction time, or pardon me, the impact test gives us a snapshot of each individual child as to how their brain works. So that if at any point during the season they are injured and we have questions, is this person concussed or not, or are they ready to return to participation or not, we then have a reference for comparison in subsequent tests. Some of these kids, when they're concussed, their reaction time is 1.5 seconds. It's three times normal, or four times normal. Clearly, they're impaired. You know, if that athlete is put back on a field, and if it takes them four times the amount to react to some trauma coming their way, they're vulnerable for injury. Or if that athlete or student is in a classroom, and it takes them four times the amount of time on a test to respond to a question, obviously they're not going to perform academically like they should. So I just want to clarify, the impact test is kind of a report card for the brain. It's not IQ test. We try to get a snapshot of how each individual child's brain works before they're ever allowed to participate in sports. So that if at any point subsequently they get injured, we now know they're... We have an objective way to determine, are they ready to go back to play or not? Are they ready to go back to school or not? Sorry about that.
No. Does that make sense? Any questions on that when we're in there?
Just to, do you know, if they're taking these every 2 years, then some of them are taking them two or three times during the course of their career. Do you note changes and whether or not, you know, they had a concussion incident or nothing that was that rose to the level of needing a follow-up impact test? But
we know there are national standards. There is some maturation of your brain. So if we look at an impact test of a freshman versus an impact test of a junior, there is some change in the scoring. Okay. So we do the repeat baselines to establish a current study. Mm-hmm. We will not allow a player to go back to participate unless their post-injury numbers are equal to or above their pre-injury levels. Does that make sense?
That does make sense. And I guess I'm, if we're noting differences from a kid takes a test as a freshman, mm-hmm. and is retested as a junior, and there's no reported
concussion
injury, but is there a way to determine if there's any significant, aside from the normal maturation of the brain, mm-hmm. a significant change in the impact test that's wouldn't necessarily indicate that they were full-blown concussion but had some
repetitive trauma?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
We do compare all baselines from year to year to year.
Okay.
And if there's any deviance or if there's any concern, then there are further testing that's done. It's called neuropsychological assessment, which is really about a four-hour test where, you know, multiple individual components are broken down.
Okay.
And even when they take a baseline test, there is some factors that go into those as far as if it's a valid baseline or not. So kids can't just come in and go, I'm going to blow this thing up and click buttons here. There's a whole lot of markers that come with the test so that we know that when they're done, they have a valid baseline. And that's, you know, even if they took the test the second time, if all of a sudden the first time they took it, you know, 2 years ago it was valid, now it's invalid, we're going to retest them again and go, was this just a fluke day? Did they not get enough sleep? Did they try to, you know, pass off this test and go, well, I'm gonna try to get my numbers as low as I can. So there are markers, and it really does help that way to find out, are they giving full effort? And just looking through the test, it's really easy to see the kids who are giving full effort or not.
Okay. But that's also when we look at it and say, like the slides are, this is not the end all be all, this is one test that we utilize as a tool. Mm-hmm. And we really do rely more on clinical judgment. But then we use this as one of the tools as well to go along and sometimes go with the clinical judgment to say, see, I didn't think you were quite right and the test proved it. Or, boy, you're acting really good and I think you're good and the test proved it. You know, so it is a tool. But like Jason said, sometimes kids can have a bad day.
Sure.
You know, I've had a kid put the fingers, you have to do a test, you have to put your fingers on a button. He came out and said, I have my fingers on the wrong button. And he got a 0% on that one. I'm like, you did have your fingers on. You know, we retested, did fine. Okay. You know, but that day, but yeah, over time it does move on. So, so that's impact. Any other questions on impact? We'll talk about it in a little bit. All right. So injuries are going to happen. We all know that. And people think, oh, it's football. It's football. It's football. Football. When I do my parent talks, when I do our academic accommodations, I tell people, guess what sport I've seen the worst concussion in all my time?
Volleyball.
Volleyball. She slipped in the locker room after a game and hit her head on the floor in the shower. Had nothing to do with sport. And the three concussions I'm dealing with currently right now, all sledding. All sledding. So again, this is not a football test. It's not a soccer test. It can be anywhere. And we do see anyone, they don't have to be an athlete, we'll see. I've seen teachers with concussions, you know, that have come in and said, I did this, what should I do? You know, so injuries are going to happen, so what do we do next? You know, on the field, we have a plethora of tools available to us. We have two different paper forms that, again, I just put little pictures up there, we could talk about them, like we could talk for hours. But we go through an on-field assessment, and we go through and we ask pointed, very pointed questions about all kinds of things. And then there's a thing called a SCAT-2 that does the same thing. We go through and we give scores, and that will, you know, help us to not determine if they have a concussion, because we can generally tell when people have a concussion, but it's more so we can show them, here's the score that you had today. And then we can show coaches, we can show parents, say, here's how they scored on this test. This is in no doubt a concussive episode, and then that, you know, requires removal from play. So then it's really not for our information, because we can generally, I'll speak for myself, I can generally tell the way they act. But when we go through the paperwork, now that's pen on paper, actual evidence we can show anyone and say, here's why we're doing this. It's not because you're the best player on the other team and I'm really working for Green Bay East and I want them to win. It's because this is how it works, okay? The other thing that we have at our thing now is it's a state law. I have to do this. You know, I cannot allow you to return with these symptoms. That would go against the law, which has my medical license. I work underneath his medical license, and I like my job. I like living here in Green Bay. I don't really want to move, okay? So when someone does get hurt, we go through a litany of paperwork. And we ask them all the detailed questions you've probably heard. The next sheet is what generally goes home with them. Okay, we have an information sheet that goes home with, I don't care if they're home team, away team, goes home with the coaches, parents. This is how we communicate home. And it tells them, here's what happened. Here's the symptoms that they had. Here's what they experienced when they were with me. And then the most important thing on the back is, here's what you need to do today. Here's what you need to do today. So I just put on there, it's okay to do this. There's no need to do this, and do not do this. And that's usually when the parents' ears perk up. They're like, oh, I don't have to wake them up every hour. That's what my mom always had to do to me. I'm like, well, actually, that's not what, you know, medical proves. That's not what the research has proved anymore. Here's what you need to do. Okay? And then on the bottom, it's here's what to look for. So whenever anyone has a concussive episode, this is what they're going home with. Okay? And then we usually send home phone numbers, and they're talking right back to us the whole time through. So on a day-to-day, you know, I couldn't tell you how many concussions we see in a year, but it's not an uncommon thing. What's happened with the prevalence of all the information in education, I believe we're seeing more, which is a good thing. We're seeing some of the ones that we never would have seen before, which will hopefully then avoid problems that these kids might have in the future by not being identified as having a concussive episode. We're able to treat them the right way. Okay? So when we go into our post-injury, when we've identified they have it, what do we do now? Again, here's another really good quote that we use. The actual injury of concussion is not the issue of this crisis, but rather the mismanagement of the injury. Okay? In years past, you got the bell ringer, take a breather, get a drink of water, get right back in there. That's what you do. That's what you do. I just gave this talk at a different school a couple weeks ago. It was right after, and I hate always talking about football, but Ben Roethlisberger went in and self-reported concussive symptoms. And I was listening to sports radio, and they called him soft. They called him weak. They said, how could you let your team down? It's the mismanagement of this injury. By not reporting what's happening, people are actually opening themselves up to further injury and further problems down the line. So we have a standardized process and flow. You know, so when someone has a concussion, we're talking to mom and dads, we're talking to coaches, we're talking to everyone that will listen to us, and we go right down through, we follow up the next day, and we put them into, again, that concussion protocol. We monitor their symptoms, and we go through every aspect of what they do. Here's where our academics from the preschool, so way back in the beginning, here's where our academic accommodations kick in. What stage are they in? We're contacting the schools, we're contacting the counselors, the teachers, the coaches, saying, you know, I believe this person's a stage three. They're gonna need some extra time between, you know, classes. They should eat in a quiet place. They might need some extra time during a test. They might need the teacher to take notes for them. They might need to share class. You know, what is it? How can we help this person to avoid this? They may need to step out. They may have a certain trigger that says, all of a sudden I'm sitting in here and after 10 minutes, these lights really start to give me a headache. I might need to have a word to the teacher. I might move to the back and I need to excuse myself for a minute. You know, so here's where our academic accommodations kick in. How are we gonna allow them to miss the least amount of educational time? We monitor their symptoms daily, either on a paper form or we do most of our documentation via computer. So we document their symptoms every day, how they're progressing, what triggers they have, how they're doing, and then we report this. We monitor them until they're symptom free. Okay, we monitor them until they're symptom free. And then we move on. So once they're symptom free, depending on how long that takes, it can be as little as a day or two. It can be 7 to 10, it can be more. So then in our protocols, we have kind of written lines where after, I believe it's 10 days, they need to go see their doctor. They've had concussive symptoms long enough, this is something that they need to go. But we're always checking with them and checking with parents. But once they are symptom free, then we go into our impact again. So now we're back to our preseason test where we had our baseline. Now we're testing them again to see if they're at their baseline. So they're answering our questions right, their balance things are good. All of our clinical evaluation tools have seemed to go well. Well, now how do they do on the computer? And then we use that tool here, all right? So once they've passed through their clinical evaluation, their symptom-free clinical evaluation, impact testing, balance testing, now we're ready to go back to sport, okay? Back in, you know, not even that long ago, boom, they just went right back to play. They were right back in, go right back into the football game, basketball game, soccer game, whatever. Today, the state, through the WIAA, and what we've done for a long time is we go through a 5-phase return, okay, to gradually wean them back in and see if symptoms arise, if any other problems arise, because the brain is a finicky organ in our body, and you could be symptom-free and do well on tests and do great, and then you get out and run, and all of a sudden, boy, I don't feel good again. I've got a bad headache. Okay, that's a sign and symptom. Our brain's not ready. So if we work through this 5-day return, our 5-phase return, and then once they complete that, now they're back to return to play. But this is a slow process, okay? Kids look at us, coaches look at us and say, I want them back. The big game is on Tuesday. We need them back. And again, where the education pieces come in, this is the process we need to go through. This is our protocol. And we don't really make exceptions through it. We pass through this because this is what's safest for the kids. Okay, and we're back to academics and we're back to sport. Okay, and this applies to just about everything. Usually by this time on our academic accommodations, they're out of the stages. They're back to full class, full study, full everything. And they're right back at it. And if they're not, if that's causing them symptoms, well, then they're not symptom-free, so we're not back in our process here. Okay? So really, as a wrap-up, concussions have not changed Our management is changing. Before, we only worried about athletic. Now we're worrying about athletic and academic, okay, more so than ever. We're really hitting those preseason tests, including the teachers, including the school, doing baseline testing. We're using our on-field evaluation skills, clinical evaluation and baseline testing and impact testing, and then our management through our academic accommodations, which I think is the biggest thing we've really added in the last couple years to really treat the entire person through the five-day return. So at a really high level, that's what we had. So are there any questions? Yes, sir.
Dr. Evans, did you want to?
I'm just going to make two comments, but I've been here since 1991 in Green Bay. And on Chad's first slide, he commented how the culture is changing. When I came to Green Bay in 1991, it was usually the norm for coaches within our school district and within Wisconsin. Their message to players was, don't go see the athletic trainer, being very honest with you. Mm-hmm, They might recognize an athlete was dinged or injured, and the mindset was, don't let anybody know. It is 180 degrees different right now. Right now, coaches have been wonderful with regard. They recognize an injury, and the first thing out of their mouth is go see the athletic trainer. They don't want to assume responsibility, which is great. Mm-hmm. Parents used to come into clinic, you know, beckoning you to release an athlete because they had a big game, or you know, someone was coming to watch the game, potentially a college program was coming to watch. And the mindset was, you know, we want him back on the field. Please give us permission to let him go back on the field. Now I have patients coming in saying, I think he might be concussed, or parents coming in. It's really, education has done wonders with the coaching staff and with parents in general. And I really think the health of the athlete is now the priority. It's not the result of the game, which I think is fantastic. With that, there is some hysteria too. And with that, there's a lot of fear and anxiety. There's a lot of misunderstanding with regard to what concussions are. You know, concussions are a transient or temporary alteration level of consciousness that occurs as a result of a blow to the body or to the brain. It's a temporary thing. Concussions are reversible, period, if we manage them correctly. And I think what's happened historically, and we all see these newspaper articles and we see documentaries and so forth, but for years and years and years, athletes would have a concussion, they'd be back out on that field, and that brain never would have recovered from concussion number one. And they're back out there, and before, and they get concussion number two and three and four and five. We know there's a window where the brain is much more vulnerable to another concussion. We know if you haven't responded or recovered from your first concussion, it would take much less of a blow to get a second one. And I think, you know, that's the past. We did not have, when I came here in 1991, an objective way to determine whether someone was truly recovered from a concussion, other than what they told you.
Right.
And people learn the game.
Self-report.
You go to your doctor's office. Number one, tell him you don't have a headache. Mm-hmm. And number two, he's going to do this neurologic exam on you, which is a very insensitive test, and just about any one of us in this room at any time could pass that test. So kids learn, and parents knew. Tell them you don't have a headache. Don't mention headache, because if you have a headache, they're not going to let you go back to play. There isn't as much of a way to fool us anymore. I mean, we have objective data. And they're all tools. No test out there is perfect. But we have balance tests we do. We have the impact tests we do. We have clinical evaluations that we do. And then we have this five-day graded return to play, where they have to be able to perform. And the degree of exercise that they have to do each day is a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. If you get a concussion this day and age, you're going to miss minimally a week. Minimally. In all likelihood, you're going to probably, it's going to be more of a 7 to 14 day thing. Mm-hmm. You know, in 1991, it was probably a 24 hour thing. So I think we're really on the front end of this. And, you know, Chad's point was, we're seeing more concussions. I think we're seeing more concussions up front, but we're seeing far fewer secondary concussions. And I can look at my own data. I know I saw 372 concussions, I think, the year before last. That was ultimately referred in to me from athletic trainers. And this year I saw 147. You know, so I think we're really on the front end of it. And I do think the culture has changed, and everybody is well-intended, including coaches and parents. And that's very different than 25 years ago.
Mike.
Thank you for your presentation, very informative. I'd like to talk a little bit more about the academic accommodations. You mentioned that if a student at a game suffered a concussion, the school is informed. I'd like a little discussion on how that information goes from the school to the individual teachers. And then, obviously, individual teachers aren't experts in signs of concussion after that. How are things followed up with teachers for, maybe some students would, the symptoms may last or accommodations a day or two, sometimes it might be longer. How is that followed in the school?
Sure, I can answer that one. I can't speak for how it works at Green Bay. I work at Bayport right now. I can tell you that when we receive a concussion, I contact whichever the counselor is for that student. Usually it's through an email. I send them one of the forms that has, what are their triggers? And that's really what we try to avoid is their triggers. You know, is it artificial lighting? We might move them, towards a window and get them a little bit more natural light if we can. Is it busy hallways? We have athletes who go down a hallway and the movement of other people around them gets them so dizzy, they have to hold onto the wall and wait for everybody to go. So we excuse them a little earlier. So it's really just working through that counselor who then at Bayport helps me with the teacher. So I don't have to try to get every teacher because I don't know every teacher that they have. But we all work as one group through emails and they come and find me if they have questions on it. But it has worked really well this year. We started it last year, but we officially did the presentation this year. But that's been the easiest. And it's communication with the parent, with the teacher. When the counselor gets the note, they bring the student in and go, are you comfortable with all these? You know, I might say they're really light sensitive. Is there any way we can either have them wear a hat or sunglasses? And in my room, they'll say, sure. And they'll get them in the counselor and like, well, I don't want to stand out. I don't want to wear that, even though it will help them. So it's really a giant communication piece and keeping everybody in the loop. And it's constant communication.
How do the students, four or five or six teachers, how do they know when to stop giving the extra accommodations that are needed for that student? How do they know?
Sure.
We work through the counselors.
Yeah, I send out a new email that says instead of them being in stage three or four where they need a lot of accommodations, I might move them up a stage, start taking things off. So it's just another email that goes to them that says this is their new accommodations or they're free of accommodations. And even after that, the email says, even though that they're free right now, if I might give them a, it's stage five is they need nothing, just like our return to play. Five is they go back to practice. Five is they're back at school full time, but I still want them to watch them for a while. You know, did this A student now turn into a C student? Maybe they're somehow got through impact tests, they got through everything else, and they say they're feeling fine, but they're really not. So I have them watch for a while. You know, we make sure that, A, they didn't fall so far behind that they can't catch back up. So again, it's just a lot of communication with that teacher.
And Kim, I assume that's part of our staff's professional development, so the teachers are aware of this and aware of the process and the procedures?
Yep.
I can speak on that.
Okay.
Chad's been doing this now for
five
years. At our beginning August days with the staff, we set aside about half an hour for Chad to come in. He gives a presentation. All the staff sees who Chad is. Chad explains where his office is, how he's going to communicate, and those type of things. So they know who he is. And from there on, it's going through our counselors, and he'll walk down and talk to the counselors and go from there.
Thank you.
I think it's another hat that we've had to ask our counselors to wear.
Mm-hmm.
And as a former counselor, we don't have concussion training when we go through our educational courses. So we have to make sure, and we're not expecting them to do the assessments, but we are expecting them to help us carry out those accommodations. So another piece where they're just going to have to kind of trail that kid along until he's free to go.
And just aside for that, as of 2014, all states have a concussion law as far as return to play. There's more and more states that are starting to do academic, so schools have to have a rule and a set guideline of how they're treating concussions as they come in. So when we brought this out, it was trying to get everybody ahead of, eventually Wisconsin will probably adapt a law that says you need to prove that you have a policy in place for academia. So once it's gone, you know, once that comes, it's like, great, we're done. Ours is already there.
I would say from a physician's perspective, this is an evolving entity. And, you know, I think I commented on 1991 versus now, but from then until now, and particularly over the last 4 years, there's been evolution with regard to concussion management. The academic piece, I think, is the most recent piece, and it needs to be perfected, it needs to be tweaked. There still are some resistances, I think, within the school districts at times, and I understand that. I always talk to parents and talk to the kids, but it's, I think Jason's point was a good one, or Chad's point was a good one. If somebody has an ankle injury and they're in a cast, it's visible, you can see it. You know they're not normal, you know they can't participate in Phi Ed for 6 weeks until they're healed. When someone walks into your class and they're socializing with the rest of people and they look pretty normal and they're, you know, casually, you can't really tell much of a difference. So you get a little bit more of a resistance from teachers sometimes. There's not quite the understanding that although they're an everyday kid, academically, they may not be who they were a week ago. And I understand that because it's not something you can see or touch. But I do think through processes like these, education, the teachers are much, much more receptive. The counselors have been fantastic. I also know our day and age is becoming so competitive that if an athlete or student isn't capable of performing the way they ordinarily would for a 3 or 4 week interval of time, and they're that A student and close to the top of their class and they get a C or on a few exams, I know how that can impact their academic standing in the big scheme of things and a lot of sequela from there on. So I think the big process is communication. But again, I look at a few years ago, just like there was resistance with coaches and how they've totally changed their game, the teachers have really come to understand that everybody here has the best intent of the child involved. So, but it needs to be perfected, and I think it's variable from one school to the next, but we're getting there.
Thank you.
I know that the reception that I had at Green Bay East from both my talk and then the subsequent meetings with the counselors, because that's who I work with the most, it was very well received. And they're like, this is going to be great for the kids. It is more work. It is another thing that they have to do. But when they see the benefits of it, when they actually see what can happen when the kids fall behind and we're really trying to help them not lose academic time, it's well worth it. So it's been, this is our first year doing it officially where it's stages and paperwork again, and it's been very well received, very well received.
Good. Good.
Good. Thank you.
Any other? Chris.
A couple questions, if I may. And first of all, thank you. It's been very heartening to me,
at least, to hear the state of the art, where you are right now with it and how you're helping our students. I'm not sure if this is for Kim or anyone else sitting there, but all our athletes right now, high school and middle school, presented with the impact?
So we do it outside of just football?
All of our high school athletes, I know that.
I think at middle school we all
basketball, football, soccer. All,
yes.
Thank you. And middle school is just football or others too? You're
not sure about
we're
that.
We're just doing just football at middle school. Right?
Okay. bear with me. I was going to ask sort of a pointed question. Based upon what you gentlemen know right now about sports within Green Bay and the equipment we have and the protocols that are followed by you and coaches and others, would you be comfortable in your child playing any of our contact sports?
I can answer for myself. I would be. I mean, I think that I think you can never eliminate all risk, but the risk that can be eliminated, and I think we're at this time as safe as we possibly can be. And part of the risk is putting the helmet on, and part of the risk is the nature of the game being high velocity, and whether that's football or whether that's soccer or whether that's basketball, there's risk inherent in any sport. But I would say subsequent to injury, I think we're far ahead of the rest of the country, to be very honest with you, and that isn't to be arrogant or egotistical in any way, but I think we've really made this a passion of ours, and we've really made it a point to try to do what's best for our kids. But I look at athletics in general, and I think there's a lot more to be gained by being active than there is by being inactive. Mm-hmm. And learning how to find your role on the team and the social part of the sport, and learning how to integrate your role, and that's what we all do in life. You know, we get a job someday, you have to learn what is your role within your corporation. So I feel very comfortable. My kids did play football, and I would be very comfortable with having my kids play any sport in this school district.
I think the other piece is too, so when we rolled middle school football out, I'll just use that as an example. I was able to be there for the presentation that night and really saw the care that they take when they actually fit the kids for their helmets. It's not grab a helmet and go. And it's not, I want that helmet because I really like it. It looks nicer than this one. I mean, they actually have a protocol and a process that they follow to fit those helmets based on the size of the kid, based on their head. And then I think also as a district, if you recall, we made a commitment to make sure that we were purchasing equipment that was considered to be at the highest level possible. We didn't just go out and take the lowest bid. We didn't go out. We really, really make an effort as a district to make sure that we're purchasing quality equipment.
So. The other thing I would say just in passing, but you know, concussions occur as a result of velocity. And the severity of concussion is proportionate to velocity. We look at severity of concussions in youth football. When you take a child that weighs 60 pounds and has 40 pounds of equipment on and how fast they're moving, we rarely see any significant concussive injury in the younger kids. You know, and you could almost say that severity of concussions in middle school versus high school versus college versus pros is almost directly proportionate to the amount of velocity involved. Very similar if you look at all the studies of Pop Warner football, you know, most parents, and I've got four kids, were worried about broken bones and severe injuries orthopedically. We cover Pop Warner football. How many serious injuries do you see at Pop Warner games? You get a bump, you get a bruise. Rarely do you see significant injuries. So I think we have to keep in mind concussions are velocity related. It's the size and the mass that dictates severity of concussions. In these younger age groups, we rarely see anything serious.
Thank you for your response. And I saw the other three gentlemen, their head were nodding that you'd be comfortable with. Okay, I just want to be clear on that. And one last comment, if I may. Am I assuming correctly that as athletic trainer or as a physician, if a coach or principal or athletic director try to put pressure on you to get a youngster back before you felt that youngster was ready, you would take it to the next level and let that person know?
Absolutely.
In our system. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Well, and with the state law in place, we have to get clearance. We can't have parents pressuring the coach to say, play them. That's not going to happen without that clearance. Any other questions or comments? Gentlemen, I really appreciate you joining us this evening.
Thank
it's
you.
Been very enlightening, and I really appreciate your emphasis on the academic piece, because that's not something we're hearing a lot in the press right now.
If I could do one more introduction, I think Mary Hilton is also here from Bellin, and she oversees this area. Mark works for Mary, so
she's our boss.
She's their boss. So.
Mary's our vice president of orthopedics and sports medicine at Bellin Health.
And Mary has been here before.
I just wanted to come as a representative of the organization and just again convey to you the work that these guys have done to really elevate the level of concussion identification management, and then most recently the academic accommodations. Having an education background for me, this was a very, very important undertaking that they wish to take on, and making sure that our kids are not only safe when they're on the field, but that they are able and ready to be here in school and learn, because that's really what they're here for, and the sport piece is secondary. So I thank them for the work that they've put into this, and I really thank you guys for your time and your attention and the support that we have gotten from our coaches, our athletic directors, Tim, and then Kim under her direction, to really help us in our educational piece with coaches and with parents. It's been phenomenal and just really fun to see that develop over time. We'll continue to get better with this as we learn more too. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
It's a very proactive approach.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
These guys were actually excited about being able to come and present to you tonight. It was like,
it's a very timely topic, and it's something that we take very seriously.
Well, so excited.
We thank you guys for your time.
Yes. Thank you,
Kim, for collecting the group and bringing them in. You know, it was quickly done. So.
Yeah, I mean, especially because I think that because of the movie and a lot of the buzz around the movie as it was being marketed and then released at Christmas time, I think that people are becoming more aware. Hopefully people are more aware of concussions in other sports other than football.
All sports.
Right. Yeah. My son's doctor said, I haven't seen a lot of injuries with football. And then 3 weeks later, we come in with it was an ankle injury. But yeah, so
thank you.
Appreciate that.
I was going to say, quite frankly, I'm not quite as worried about football on our level because the equipment has gotten so much better. And the helmet issue, they've been doing that for quite a while, and that continues to get better. I'm more worried about soccer, headbutting, and
wrestling,
and basketball.
Basketball
when their head meets the floor.
Right.
So, anyway.
Thank you. That was very kind.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And that concludes our portion of the work session.
Yeah, that was... Done. On to the next part.
There we go. All right.
All right, we will now move to organizational support, and that will be facilitated by Andy Becker.
All right, under business and finance, we have no discussion items, and under human resources, we have the formulary management change.
Again, we bring forward the recommendation for the advanced control formulary for medications. This is our second month to discuss it, and we had additional questions from board members and others that you received. And then I gave you some, there were three additional questions that I talked with Wayne Salverga, our consultant, about today, and I gave you a copy of the responses that he provided to me. Basically, we have currently an open formulary where most all medications are covered in the plan. If we move to an advanced control formulary, there will be exclusions, medications that are excluded from the plan. And therefore, we will have employees who will have to migrate to other medications that are substantially equivalent. The recommendation is brought forward to help, because we anticipate the cost of some medications, and also to help us control costs before pharmacy costs get away from us. We also want to maintain a good level of insurance in our pharmacy and our medical plan for all employees. And so if we can control costs up front, rather than being reactionary when the costs have escalated, we can keep the cost of the benefit in check and also provide a good level of benefit. If we were to implement this, it would take effect July 1st with the open enrollment. So we would send the information to employees at that time, but we would anticipate informing employees ahead of time right away that we're moving to this. Some highlights that we found after we talked with the board in January is that the formulary is redone every quarter. And Wayne provided in the question and answer how the changes could impact the formulary. So it is the case that some employees, if the formulary changed, would have to go to another medication. And in some cases, they would have to make an appointment with their doctor. But in most cases, it would be done via the phone. But it could entail some additional lab checks, or, for example, in a blood pressure med, some blood pressure checks. So there would be that that would occur. The other thing that Michelle asked me to check out, which I did, is if this were to be accepted and we gave it a try, could we go back to the way we currently have the formulary set up, and that we could do. The only thing that Wayne Salberta, our consultant, said is that it would have to be at a quarter point. It couldn't be in the middle of a quarter. But that would be possible. So I thought that was important for you to know. I do have a copy of the 2015 and 2016 formularies if anybody would like to look at it. It's quite a bit of paper. But I have that if a person wanted to look to see what are the medications that would be excluded and what would be the alternates that would be proposed. It's important to know, too, that there is an appeal process. And what I also learned is that in some cases, when the physician puts forward the information, it doesn't even go to appeal. It just is either approved. And if it's approved, there's no appeal. If it is denied, then it goes to appeal. So the appeal is actually second, because some of the requests from the physicians are approved right away without appeal. And I gave you some additional information that a board member asked for about the CVS Caremark appeals and denials, and you have that in that memo. Are there any questions or anything else that you need to know?
Chris?
Thank you. Looking at that question, thank you
for putting this together. It certainly helped me, at least. And I appreciate what you're trying to do with this. Looking at Ada and the chart, the first three areas in the chart, I mean, look good from the standpoint of saving the employee some money. Mm-hmm. But the fourth one, the last one first, no copay change. And maybe it could explain generally why generic to generic, why would you change if there's no copay change? And then the one before that, if I'm reading this right, 2% of the users that have to switch will have to be paying more for copay, and if you could address that.
Right. The generic, we're talking about page 2 of the question and answer, correct? So the generic to brand, I asked Wayne about that, and on the formulary there's one medication he pointed out, which is a testosterone product that is the brand is the preferred option and the generic is not. And in that case, that medication's copay is higher. And it's just the way that right now the CVS Caremark's formulary is set up. But now the employee and their physician could ask for an exclusion to that to stay on the generic. It's the only one in the entire formulary that's like that. And it's just the way the formulary is negotiated by the pharmacy agent that's acting on the district's behalf. And so this is a formulary that not just Green Bay would follow, but it's their advanced control formulary that other companies that use this would follow. And it's kind of an anomaly on that medication. The generic to generic would be almost an equivalent change with the cost being very minimal, but the cost to the employee is minimal, but the cost savings to us that we pay for the other generic that's approved would be where we would save money. But the cost to the employee would remain the same.
Okay. Other questions? Chelsea?
Yeah, thank you, Gina. I appreciate all of the information. I thought it was very, very clear. Actually, at number 8, I have a question about what's written there. So at the beginning of the paragraph, it says, based on review of claims for the 4-month period, 259 plan participants, 417 prescriptions, $370,000. Then it goes on to say, this represents 2.2% of the plan's prescriptions and 12.6% of the plan paid drug costs. So is that pointing to, I don't understand, is that pointing to where our savings would be?
This is pointing to the, I think what he's trying to point out, it's a small number of plan prescriptions that would be affected because, you know, so many, and that of the 2.2% of the plan prescriptions, it's 12.6% of the paid drug costs, over 4 months only, though.
Got it. Okay. And then there was something about rats. I'd read this, and now I can't recall. There was one other thing that I didn't understand. So here's my question about the quarterly change. So I've just been on the phone with my insurance company for like 2 hours over the last 3 weeks, trying to do a few things, trying to understand, and my pharmacy benefit, trying to understand what our new pharmacy benefit is, because the calendar year changed, trying to understand what implications there are for a child who will be attending college next year, and then also just trying to understand what the heck my plan now provides. Okay. So if there's a quarterly change, right, and you actually said it, I think, beautifully, a quarterly change in a drug may actually trigger a visit for one of our employees.
It could.
And so what I'm seeing now is some possible savings and some possible benefits for our employees, but I'm also seeing time, and I'm also seeing money. So what do you think about us keeping track of that?
Well, from what I understand, the savings are so substantial that and this was talked about at the Benefit Advisory Committee. I think Wayne's response was that the savings that you will have by adopting this formulary are much greater than the occasional extra doctor visit that might need to happen when a medication is changed. There's no cost to the employee for asking to stay on their medication, to go through the process, and I think Wayne said it's about 72 hours once they get the information. And what we'd like to do is, I think what we can do is put the formulary on the website so our employees can go and see it and look at it and understand a little bit more about their medications and what's on plan or not, because frankly that's one of the first things that a few of us did is we looked up our medication and said, I did, and said, what is it? And so you people will be interested, I think, in knowing what they're on, what are the options, and
but
we'll
then, you know, I mean, then it still triggers a conversation with your doctor, because you could have a medicine, this is the truth, that this is what's happening in my family, this is the medicine that one of my family members takes that the regular is like $1.71, and the extended release is like $172. And so my family member is on the extended release. So, you know, then that's just, it seems like a lot of work, and I'm not saying that it is not something that people shouldn't do, but it makes me cautious a little bit.
That's why I asked her to look to see if we could
monitor
it and switch back if it was really becoming so onerous to individuals and how many, and that's why we looked at, you know, in that change, how many drugs actually are changed, and, you know, because it concerns me. I think you said chasing, you know, the last time, so I spent some time really delving into it as well, and just wanting to make sure that if we find it to be, you know, not beneficial and really burdensome on employees, we would have to revisit it. And once you're in it, could you change? And they said, yeah, just timing. But that was an important question, I think.
That makes sense to me. I mean, even sometimes drugs take a little while to start working, depending on the drug. But okay, that makes sense. I thought all the answers were good. I did also like the chart of drugs, basically, and the number of people, whether it's a brand or generic. I thought that was very helpful and detailed information. Oh, this is my question. This is it. Okay, so this is the last, Andrew. There's something here about exclusions, and I was thinking, am I understanding exclusions correctly? That if it's on the exclusion list, that means it's a drug that isn't covered?
That is correct.
Right, okay. All right. Mm-hmm. That's it for me then. Thank you.
Brenda?
Maybe you said this, but I didn't hear it. Did Wayne give you a sense of how often, when a formulary medication is changed, how often patients actually need to end up in the doctor's office versus that it's taken care of over the phone?
He didn't have any, he didn't have a sense of that,
okay,
of how often that happened. That was discussed at the Benefit Advisory Committee, and I think, if I remember correctly, his response was that many cases it's done over the phone. And in some cases, the doctor might tell the patient to go in and have a lab drawn, but that they wouldn't necessarily need to be seen. Mm-hmm. There was also a question, I don't know that it was here, but you know, you go to the doctor or you go to the pharmacy, and the pharmacist doesn't know which medications you are able to be on.
Right.
And Wayne said that the pharmacists get copies of what are the meds that are covered, so if they don't know that, they ought to know it.
Okay.
When they get called by the physician, that information is sent out, and they should know that information.
Yeah, that was my husband mentioned that. Mm-hmm. He would like it to go one step further, so that when they call and say this medicine you prescribed isn't covered, and they stop there, and then, you know, he's wishing they would say, but here are three options.
This is what it is.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
This is
right. What because this, if anybody would like to see it, this is the January 2016 formulary. And if you give me the name of a medication, I can
tell you
what is on there. And then if anybody wants to see this, you can they bold the generic, or they bold the brand name, and the generics are in italics.
Right.
Yes.
Just as a follow-up, I'm well aware of, I had the conversation with my brother, who's a physician in Minnesota, that they actually have the lists of the formularies in the doctor's office. So when they do the prescription and they ask the person a question, they have that information, they can look it up right when the patient is there. So I don't know if that's anything that they could do for us, or if our healthcare providers would even be interested. If we want to.
Other questions? Okay, I have several points. I'm going to start with question 23 in the memo. There's something that doesn't sit right with me about the fact that manufacturers who have a similar drug are competing with each other not on a simple basis of pricing and offering the lowest price for the product and knowing that offering a lower price will get their drug preferred, but are rather, as it says here in the answer to question 23, they are paying rebates for what percentage of the market share that they get. And so they're actually they're saying to this formulary panel, we will give you a discount if you exclude competitors. If you push competitors out, if we get this much of the market share, rather than just, you know, we're going to reduce our price in the hopes of becoming preferred. And that, you know, doing that on a quarterly basis bothers me. And this is a philosophical question. This is not about the number of people who are likely to be affected. I get that. Mm-hmm. And I also get that of the people who will be affected, almost half of them are changing from one albuterol inhaler to another albuterol inhaler in a different camp. Okay. But I don't like that our I don't like that our members, our employees, are being, I guess, used as pawns in this, give me a better percentage of market share, and if you exclude the other guy, I'll give you more rebate. That's what concerns me, in that I don't want to see a drug going off formulary when it's a difference of the actual difference is a few dollars, because we're going to get some rebate and bouncing people around between medications. I guess a couple other questions that I have. I'm not convinced. I mean, wouldn't just by moving some of, I'll go with the least emotional example, is people changing within albuterol inhalers. Wouldn't simply moving something to a non-preferred pricing, moving it to tier three, wouldn't that generate people to switch anyways? I mean, if you have a maintenance medication like inhaler, rather than take it off formulary, wouldn't it have almost the same effect, probably, to say, hey, this is going up to $50, but the one in the blue canister, which is the same thing, will stay generic? It's a less, mm-hmm. you know, that or some kind of pre-authorization is a less dramatic thing than doing a closed formulary. And didn't we just change copays and things 1 year ago? Didn't we have some kind of
tier?
We added.
I thought we did.
Yeah. So, I'm unconvinced that we need to hit our employees with a change, a second year in a row when our pricing experience has been favorable. I am also concerned that I don't see any real. You know, I don't see this savings going right into wages. I don't see this savings going into any kind of addition of innovative benefits, or of looking at expanding what we do with smoking cessation programs and these kinds of things. We're just, every time we do this, every time we delegate more and more of what we can decide here as a board, which is the advantage of staying self-insured, right? If we went to if we bought a commercial plan, this would just be done to us, right? And we wouldn't have a choice. So here we have a choice, but it seems that we're choosing everything the big commercial organizations are going to. Anyways, and so we're delegating what drugs will be covered to a boardroom out on the East Coast instead of relying on the physicians here. I get charging more when there's a drug that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, or it's chemically equivalent, and most of these are. I don't like the generic to brand transition, bugs me, even if it's just one, but that's not the biggest thing, I guess. If we were really struggling with the health costs, if we were digging deep into health care reserves and we needed to do this, I would say let's do it, but I just don't think the per member per month savings is there. I think we can get to it less dramatic ways. The number of people, if this did disaffect some people, they get their appeals denied, we're not going back. There's never going to be a groundswell of discontent over this, because there's not that many people it's going to affect. There will just be people quietly disaffected by it. Yeah, I'm just not, the responses are good. I just don't see the need for it this year, when we could do something less drastic like prior authorization and we're in a good cost environment this year. If we were struggling, if we needed to do this to be able to give a raise because costs spiked that much, different story. That's not where we are here in 2016, and that's where I'm at.
You know, Andrew, you make a good point about the tiering, the way that we've changed the tiers, right? And other entities have too. And it's interesting because in this paragraph at 23, there's an assertion that basically tries to answer that question that you have, and it says, I think, I'm reading this correctly, proliferation of co-pay offset programs has mitigated the ability of higher co-pay tier approach to effectively move market share. And so that gets back to kind of what my concern was a month ago, you know, okay, so now we have to do this other thing to move the cost of drugs, and what's next? So, and I'm not really disagreeing with you, but it seems like, because that paragraph was interesting to me, and I think you make a good point, and I think that he tried to answer that question by saying that, nope, we have to go one step further in order to move the market share.
Sure, I guess the most egregious example is the Trexamet, two drugs that are, it's a generic Imitrex and a generic Advil pushed together into one pill for $26 a pill instead of $1.50. That's clearly an abuse in the system. But that's just, there's only a few cases of this on this list. And sure, you see a copay offset program for Trexamet, and they're going to sell a bunch of it until their game is up. But I still think the copay offset program is there, and it's going to get abused by some manufacturers, but there's not a copay equivalent card to stay with the blue albuterol inhaler instead of switching to the red one, and that's far more cases up here. That's where these people are bidding to push their if you push our competitor out of the market, we will pay you, and that just doesn't sit well with me. I'm kind of surprised it is legal. It seems anti-competitive to me, though I'm no expert on that, but it certainly smells like it. I don't see any evidence here that copay waiver cards are nailing us for hundreds of thousands of dollars. I just don't, and we could certainly do encourage our providers to educate on some of these crazy ones like the Trexamet, which is just a few people. I use one of these inhalers, and I went to the pharmacist, and I was told that in my particular case, it was a plan that moved it off formulary, though the cost impact wouldn't have been that much. It was $23 versus $5 or something. But that was, whether that would have been a $18 difference in copay or coming off formulary would have had exactly the same effect on me. I would have said, why did it go up? Is there a difference? No? Okay, I don't care. It wasn't dispenses written. The day might come when we need to do this, but I really am not seeing that that's here yet. And it also concerns me that we have what we had prior to Act 10 was we had a give and take environment that may have assured that some drug savings here would have gone into making another part of the health plan more robust, or would have reduced a copay or kept a copay from going up across the board, or been tied to some working condition or some little bit better increase in the salary. Now these are standalone things. I don't see us coming you know, maybe if this was part of a package to fund doing something really unique and different to help our members, I'd maybe think about it. But this is just another take. And then I think in a year or 2 years, you know, prescriptions will go up, and so we would just do copays again or take more things off the formulary again. Well, in fact, it won't even need board action anymore, because every quarter a boardroom in the executive boardroom on the East Coast will do it for us. So I just don't, it's taking things too far, and I won't be able to support. Brenda?
What was our increase in prescription drug costs over the last year?
I was just thinking, I think it was double digit, 13%. I have it in my other
folder. I thought
it went
from 3 to 9.9.
It's close to 10, 10%? Close to 10 now?
Yeah.
So, yeah, went double digit.
I mean,
But how much is that per member per month? To take, if you're looking at just the prescription piece of the health care and increasing it by 10%, that's not very much, I don't think.
Well, I think our total drug costs were go around $800,000 to $900,000 a year.
$910,000 or $990,000.
Yeah. It's close to $1 million. It will be approaching $1 million. So, you know, I think that.
But that's not $1 million of increase.
Right.
That is $1 million.
We pay it out of right out of.
Oh, it's $1 million of increase?
Not of increase, no.
No, it's a hundred, you know, it's really, when you talk about $900,000, that sounds, you know, that sounds pretty scary, but in fact, it's 10% of that, or even if it increases, you know, 13, divided by 2,000 plus people. So this isn't the huge. Right, I mean, we're not talking that many dollars per person per month here.
But what's the estimated savings that would going on a formulator?
Wayne had said 700,000
per year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But what are we spending on prescriptions right now?
It's close to, I think, $1 million.
I think we should probably look at that because
yeah, I think you should, because. Yeah.
That's a
because this is not,
savings.
We are not going to save.
We're not. No.
Yeah, we're not going to save 70%.
We spend
close to $10 million in prescriptions a year, and I don't know if Jennifer has access to it back there or not. And I think the increase from last year is close to $900,000,
which makes sense
above last
right.
year.
Yep.
So we went from 9.1 to 10 million or around that. It went up this.
Yeah.
The trend of last year by $1 million.
Yeah.
Right.
So I mean,
I don't mean to contradict Gene.
You're correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I mean, I look at this as a chunk of money that we're looking at, a budget that we have to balance next year, and we're not getting any more money from the state or anybody, and it's. I mean, we can't spend the same as what we spend now, and so it comes down to where can we save money with least impact on the classroom, balancing the needs of our employees, obviously, because you know, I mean, we can't put all this on their backs, but it to me it's a balance, and it's obviously. Going to inconvenience 259 of our employees, but as we start looking at other ways to cut $700,000, you know, then you start looking at positions, and you know, you're cutting from, you know, and making workloads more difficult or things like that. I mean, it's just to me, it's a balance of trying to figure out how to balance our budget in bad economic, you know, not bad economic times, but
yeah,
at a time when we're not,
yeah.
But at a time when we're not getting money is what I, you know,
right,
is what I mean.
Right.
I mean, it's no fun.
It's not fun. I think it is critical to be a little more proactive rather than waiting for us to be in absolute dire straits.
Yeah. I mean, if we went up from 3% to, it was 3% of our, what was that number?
Yeah, I think it was 3.
It was in that, yeah.
Yeah, it was in this handout. To 3.3%.
Yeah, to the first one.
Was the trend. The Wisconsin RX Cooperative, which is our agent, is 8.2, and now we're like 9.9, I think.
Yeah.
So we're higher than their average for 2015. Yeah. You know, and the thing is that we really want to keep a good health plan and good and a good pharmacy benefit, but in order to do that with the cost of the pharmaceuticals going up, which is what everything tells us is happening, and the competitive nature, we want to do this now so that we can roll it out in a way where we have time to message it to our employees and they have time to plan for it. And that's why the timing now, so that it can be people have enough time to think about the changes. And you know, at any given point, any one of our employees and their families could be faced with a change, because that formulary does change on a quarterly basis. But it's a way that our consultants are trying to say to us, we're here to try to help you keep your costs down, but yet maintain a plan that's good for your members, your employees, and their families. And that's why and you know, pharmacy costs, the way they leverage this is through that market share. I mean, you're right, Andrew. They're saying, we've got this many people, these many covered lives, and so we can demand a lower priced drug. And if drug companies don't want to play, then they're excluded. That's the competitive forces at play here. So
it's an unfortunate game that we're stuck in the middle of playing.
But you know what we're not doing, and we've not taken any. We've not done any things like looking at things that have been traditionally not covered because of an insurance model that doesn't look at, for example, and I talked to an actuarial professor at Madison about this, the impact of funding smoking cessation. Do you pay a little bit for that, knowing that it'll get health rewards? Now that question is, the answer is almost certainly yes, although it actually got muddled in the study that happened because life insurance costs went higher because people lived longer, so it kind of fizzled out to an inconclusive thing. But there was no doubt that there would be long-term health savings. But the commercial insurance industry ignores that because they assume you'll be someone else's member every few years. We have much more longevity than other places, and we're self-insured. Yet we don't do that. Why? I'm sure the why is because other places don't do it. Well, other places aren't self-insured with their own ability to make novel decisions.
We do cover smoking cessation, though. I think
I'm picking on an example. No. I could pick on. Yeah, and isn't it a relatively narrow? Isn't it just like drug treatment only?
I'm not sure, but under the Affordable Care Act, I think that changed that. It's covered.
Drug treatment is, but there's
The other alternative therapies may not be.
And I'm talking about research-based things where we could demonstrate actuarially that there would be savings over 10 years. Mm-hmm. But there won't be in 3, so the insurance industry never covers them. I've never heard about any of those types of approaches except when I've been the one saying it, yet whatever new cut or price increase is coming down the pipe, we're just jumping on board and taking advantage of an environment where we don't have to negotiate anymore. If we were in a give-and-take environment, I probably would have been done talking about this 29 minutes ago, because there would have been an offset of something else, which isn't going to happen here. And I don't like getting involved in this game until such time as we really need to be in it. And I just don't think that is right now. And if there was a plan for where the savings would be directed, I might feel differently. But it's just general savings in a plan that's already coming in way ahead of expected costs. So, all right, anything else, Chris?
Yeah, if I may, certainly all good points all the way around. The market share piece, I guess I look at it a little bit differently. It doesn't bother me as much. It is the way the market works. And if we look, and it may not be a good analogy, but hip replacement in this country is very expensive. If you go to Great Britain, it really isn't. And why isn't it in Great Britain? Because they have socialized medicine, and they put an RIP out there for who can provide these hip replacements, the physical part. So they get a much, much better price. So it seems to me that, to me, a little bit analogous to what we're trying to do or what's trying to be done here with different prescriptions. I appreciate you being proactive on this. It may not be a great savings, but my experience is, as I look around at, and again, maybe not a good analogy, I see people of similar incomes, and some people with those incomes seem to do a lot better than others. And in my mind, it's not one major thing. It's that they're prudent looking at different expenses and how, where their money goes, and have a plan for it. It's a matter of saving a little bit here, a little bit there, for those families to do better. And I think, to me, that's somewhat like an organization. You know, there's not, you don't, seldom do you find some major thing that you can save billions of dollars unless it's letting blood out. And so you've got to look at things like this to find the money. And I realize there's not a straightforward saying, okay, now this money saved here will go into teacher salaries, but certainly it's going to go into the system to help support teachers with our kids, in my opinion. Thank you.
Chelsea?
One last comment. You know, I what I would like the public to know and our employees to know as we consider this is that, you know, I think that the seven of us, and Ed is absent tonight, seven of us joined by Dr. Langenfeld and the staff, we understand exactly how much is at stake when we make these kind of changes. And, you know, what Chris just mentioned about hip replacements, I mean, this is very much at the cutting edge of how people think about healthcare in the United States, not just, you know, socialized medicine model, but also what works best, what you know, various hip pieces work best in various people's bodies. And so I think the seven of us, bring that knowledge to the fore and ask those questions as we make these changes, albeit these changes are difficult. We want to see our employees, we want to do right by our employees, but we do have to watch this bottom line, especially as Brenda mentions, in an ever-shrinking resource world. So I just wanted to say, give us some kudos for asking the right questions.
Michelle?
If I could, as just a point of reference, knowing that we've increased the cost, do we have any sense of who and what are we? I'm of an age, for example, where I may be, you know, retiring, or I'm not announcing, by the way, but just in case anyone's playing along at home. But I look at that and I say, as we look at our demographics and the people we have on our plans, and I know we extend our plan, just because I leave the district or what have you and retire doesn't mean I'm no longer covered. Is that accurate?
Yes.
And do we have any sense of that? You know, or do we not have any sense of where this additional increase is coming from? I'm not suggesting there's a population, just a sense of, are we shifting in need, and is the need going to continue to grow, I guess, as well?
Well, drug therapy is growing. I mean, as
everywhere.
Yeah, there are more drugs on the market and more brands coming to the market, okay, which costs money, but also can prove very useful tools for physicians to prescribe, because it can do a great deal of good
for
people, right?
For whatever.
Yeah. And you know, in some of the things that might be excluded, like the slow release medications, might be approved if a person needs to take it because they can't remember to take a drug three times a day. So that might be something where the extended release is approved.
Yeah.
So there are quite a few exceptions that can be made.
Okay.
So would the board be then willing to advance this to a recommended motion on the 15th at the regular board meeting in February? If there are any other questions, I can get back to Wayne and get the answers in the meantime.
Okay. And that is it.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. We do have a closed session. I'll read that motion. Closed session has been scheduled for Monday, February 1st, 2016, immediately following the adjournment of the work session meetings. Pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851C, considering employment, promotion, compensation, or performance evaluation data of any public employee over which the governmental body has jurisdiction or exercises responsibility, and pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851F, considering financial, medical, social, or personal histories or the investigation of charges against specific persons, except where paragraph B applies, which if discussed in public would be likely to have a substantial adverse effect upon the reputation of any person referred to in such histories or data or involved in such problems or investigations, to wit, personnel matters. Pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851E, deliberating or negotiating the purchasing of public properties, the investing of public funds, or conducting other specified public business whenever competitive or bargaining reasons require a closed session, more specifically, to wit, negotiation of collective bargaining agreements. And pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851C, considering employment, promotion, compensation, or performance evaluation data of any public employee over which the governmental body has jurisdiction or exercises responsibility, to wit, employee compensation. The meeting will begin in open session to consider the appropriate motion for closed session so provided by law.
So moved. Second.
Sandy?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Carried 6-0. We'll convene across the hall.
Tomorrow.